Welcome to VidDevo Church. Sort of. Actually, this is School of the Bible. And we've started a new series because we wanted to get back into the Bible and into studying the scriptures, but also to address some things, discuss some things, have a conversation, as it were, to have an argument, meaning the logic description of what a logical argument is, meaning that you take A and define it, take B and define it, and you come to a conclusion, A plus B equals A plus B. That's logic. That would be the presentation of an argument. And discussing sentence and structure and language, we might get into how an argument has become arguing in America. But that's not what an argument really is in critical thinking or in logic or in understanding, really, the scriptures. And that's what we want to talk about today in School of the Bible. We want to discuss understanding. We want to appreciate wisdom. We want to, as it were, take the Word of God by the Spirit of God to the people of God, of the Son of God, Jesus, and to apply that comprehension of that phrase or aphorism to our lives, in meaning this: it's nice to say something, but it's a lot better to do something. In other words, each and every one of us can say a certain amount of spiritual truths, but is that what we do? Is that how we live? Is that what we are? A W Tozer lots of times address those conflicts, those confrontational issues that, on the one hand, when you go to church, you expect to be confronted with someone speaking truth to you, and somehow the Spirit of God telling you that it's you. You are the one. It's about you, and maybe that's a good thing. Maybe the Spirit of God, while you're sitting in a pew, is talking to you, and they're talking about something wonderful, and you go, "Ah, that's me, I'll take that one," and you sign your name to it. But what if God is real? Okay, that's our basic premise. What if God is real? My summation of the premise is that, yes, God is real. Now, a lot of people say God is real. A lot of people proclaim God is real. You even have movies that say God's not dead, he's surely alive, he's roaring on the inside, you know, like a lion or something. Now, I'm not sure what that is. It sounds like indigestion to me, but okay, you know, I get the idea. But what if God is real? What if there is not only a God, but the God, we'll say the God of gods? You know, the creator of everything, the one who is called, quote, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the one who I like to say in my VidDevo days, you know, when I was recording VidDevo every day, four or five times a day, or maybe six or seven, the God of me, the God of who he is because of what he made me to be that I am, meaning that I am that I am is a phraseology of describing God, but that's not who he is. That's what he is in some ways. I am that I am is also another way to interpret that. And another way that that phrase Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh or Jehovah or Yehovah or however you want to say it and play games with really isn't his name, by the way. But one way of interpreting is I am that I am, or I am, as Christians like to use. Another way of interpreting it that's equal and just as powerful is I am that I am, or let's see, the way that Christians interpret is I am. Another way that people interpret is I am that I am, and the last way that is just as equal and is equal to all three is I will be what I will be. And I like that because that's the Jewish way of looking at it. It says, to my people, I will be what I will be. To the Gentiles, they will trust in the name of Jesus. So the great I am is what a lot of Gentiles or non-Jewish people will say, oh, you know, we like Jehovah or we like Yahweh or Yahweh or, you know, whatever they come up with, Yahyas. You know, but I am that I am is simply the reality of what he meant to say, and what he does apply to himself is simply that we don't know what he is. He just is that he is. That is what God is. He is, period. So being that said, being that done, my God, as I often have to use that phraseology to separate myself from what you might say or they might say or he, she, or it might pray, my God is real. My God is real not only because I know him, but because he makes himself real to me. And the way he makes himself real to me is, A, he speaks to me. B, he demonstrates his love towards me in that while I was yet a sinner, he gave his son for me, and I got saved, and I got born again. I experienced all these unbelievable gifts, emotions, and things that went on in what people call a Christian life. Though it could just as easily be called a Jewish life, it could be called a real life, it could be called life, really, because, frankly, before I was born again, that wasn't much of a life. It was just existence. But now I have a life that is eternal. So words, as we're going to learn in school the Bible, are very important to understanding not just the Bible, because that's one thing that we're going to talk about tonight and today, but that there's more to the Bible than meets the eye. You see, the Bible in and of itself, and we'll discuss this in another teaching on School of the Bible, the Bible in and of itself is just a book. And we say that a lot on Sunday mornings. Hey, you know, it's a good book. Don't get me wrong. It's a good read. It has a lot of philosophy, a lot of poetry, a lot of wisdom, a lot of knowledge. Oh, it's got the history of mankind. It's got the future destiny of mankind. It's got pretty much everything in it. But it's only a book. It's not perfect. It's not imperfect. It's a book. A book is a book is a book. That's what Biblios means, the book of books. It is a book. But just like we said that the word for God means I am, and it means I am that I am, and it means I will be what I will be, in and of itself trying to explain that he is as he is, the way he is, what he is. There's often in scriptures three things you can draw from in some way. That which was, that which is, that which shall be. Or I like to say Father as he explains it to me, the Son as he explains it to me, the Spirit as he explains it to me. Or perspectives from the Father, Son, and Spirit. You know, there's tripartite ways of looking at things and understanding things. And what I mean by that is that when you look at the Bible, the book is a book. That's what it is. Now, it's a special book, that being that it is recorded in some ways very accurately according to the scrolls we've been given. But the exact details of what might have been said to some people might not be the exact details of what was recorded. After all, Luke says, hey, I went and spoke to the people and I wrote down what they remembered. Now, a lot of people say, well, you know, the Bible inspired them to remember. Well, okay. But here's the third part that I like. The spiritual part. The Bible is a spiritual book. Okay, so it's a book. It's a book of books, but it's a spiritual book. Now, that last part is what most people forget, and that's what we're going to get into in a minute, is that the book itself is just a book unless it's treated as a spiritual book. Because without the key to unlock the Word of God, it's just a book and it doesn't become the Word of God, unless the Spirit of God gives it life. In other words, I didn't know God until God gave me life. I didn't understand God until God gave me wisdom. I didn't become born again until God changed me. I could not have done it of myself. I could not learn it by myself. I could not find God by myself. As a matter of fact, except that God revealed himself to me, I would not know God. God had to come across the gap that was between me and God. I never would have known there is a God. I would not have known about God. I would not have even conceived of coming up with a God. As a matter of fact, I was pretty happy with my science fiction. I had all kinds of gods, worlds, dimensions, realities. I was having fun. I enjoyed my perspective reading nothing but science fiction and just oh boy, you know, when I found libraries, I could check out books, and I checked out every science fiction book there was and read almost every author there was at that time. And then I'd get paperback books, and on and on and on it goes. But if God hadn't intervened in my life, I wouldn't know there's a God. So my primary way of finding God was God found me, and he revealed himself to me. I automatically knew immediately there was a God because he did it. I didn't do it. I couldn't have. And that's what we're going to talk about tonight, one way of knowing God, is that it was by God choosing to reveal himself to me that I found God. I wasn't raised religious. I didn't know anything about God. I didn't understand God. There was nothing in my background that would have brought me to a place of knowing God. As a matter of fact, I probably would have known Satan a lot sooner, or the devil or whatever, than I would have known God because of all the things that were involved in the world in my day. But, hey, one day, you know, they laid hands on me, which was different than an altar call, and I got saved. You know, and praise the Lord, here I am today. But we want to read something to you that is going to talk about this difference between the book of books, and a spiritual book. We want to talk to you about being in and of this school, the school of the Bible, that you should be able to learn by yourself, of yourself, and this school of the Bible is to teach you to learn with God, to be taught by God. A promise that was made in the book, the history book, the part of the simple book without it being the spiritual book, was that at one point in time, a man recorded that there would come a time when God himself would reveal himself to his people, and he would tell them things that were going to happen. He would tell them certain things they had to do and certain ways they had to live. And when that time came, he spoke directly to that person, and that person recorded directly exactly what they heard, according to what the person said. Now, that is what we call the Torah, and it was spoken to Moses in the burning bush and the whole experience. God demonstrated himself to Moses by revealing himself to Moses, and Moses wasn't happy with that. Moses was like, hey, you know, the burning bush is a nice trick, but hey, I want to know you more. I want more of you. I'm not content with just this. I want to see you. And God kind of, you know, it's almost like you get this image of God going, chuckling a little bit like, you have no idea, buddy. If I were to reveal myself, you'd be toast. You'd be post-toasties on the, you know, unholy ground that you walk in and live in. But being that God had prepared Moses, he gave Moses part of what he wanted, you know, and it's kind of where we get this whole idea of I saw the Lord, he's high and lifted up in his train, filled the temple, you know, blah, 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 blah. You know, we perceive a certain amount of what we think God is, we understand a certain amount of what God says he is, but we really don't know God at all because God says he can't know me. So I can see God kind of chuckling going, you don't know. But that's okay. He saw what Moses recorded as his afterparts, or God passed by him. And I like that because the pass by him is almost like passed over him. And I think it was more of a passed over him than a pass by him, because later we get Passover. But hey, that's my own personal opinion. So in and of itself, unless God chooses to show you, you don't know. Unless God chooses to speak to you, you don't know. Unless God chooses to reveal to you, you don't know. You can get yourself ready to know by studying and practicing and reading and theology and all these weird ideas. And maybe, you know, you'll figure out a way that you can approach God. Hey, I got good news for you. The good news is you can call upon him anytime and he'll reveal himself to you. The bad news is you got to mean it. You see, the good news is God will reveal himself. The bad news is you got to mean it. It says in the way that it's recorded in the book of books, the Bible and all that, that, you know, they that search for me must search for me with all their heart. Well, you know, that sounds sweet. Yeah, God, I'll search for you with all my heart. That's not what he means. Well, you know, God, I really mean it. No, that's not what it means. It's pretty intense what he means. And it's like when you're desperate and you're out of options, God, you know, that's about the time that God will reveal himself, you know. Now, there are other ways that Jesus has said, as being the Son of God, that we could find God without having to go through the end result of it being desperation at the last minute, crying out, oh, God, help me! And God says, okay. You know, you go, oh, well, that was easy. Why couldn't I have done that before?
Well, you really won't accept it because you don't mean it. You see, that's where you have to kind of bring yourself to a place where you mean it. God operates on an interesting level that has nothing to do with what we think. It has everything to do with what he says. And that's where we start today. Understand this. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 is everything about the school of the Bible. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him. He'll direct your path. That means you can't do it. You won't do it. You don't know it. And it ain't going to happen the way you think it's going to happen. Everything that you understand is wrong. Everything that you believe isn't right. You need to kind of get to a place of you accept it. And that ain't faith, baby. That's just simply going, hey, my programming is needing to be deprogrammed so that I can start from scratch. It's kind of like when Windows, you know, you put your Windows operating system into a computer and it doesn't work. Whoops, I need an update. Well, if you've ever bought a Mac, you don't need a Windows. Sorry, it's a problem with the programming. Not a problem with the Windows, but the programming underneath. That's your problem. It's your programming is wrong, so you can't understand God any more than, you know, a Mac can become a Windows or a Windows can become a Mac. The programming's wrong. Now, Macs can play Windows on top of Mac, and Windows can play Mac on top of Windows. Don't work so well, but they can do it for a little while until something major happens. Then you go back to just having a Mac, because believe me, something major happens in Windows, you don't like it. And they still don't got it right, but they're working on it. So what we want to do now is to get right our programming. We want to get our education, as they used to say, to edification. We don't want to stick with education only. We want to come to a place of edification, meaning that we edify that with which God is abiding in us with. In other words, God does something interesting. He comes inside and he says, hey, ooh, your insides stink to high heaven. What have you been eating? Well, yeah, you can smell it because he's inside. And that's kind of a long story, and we'll explain that later. But for now, let's just stick with, we need to understand this education process for the edification of ourselves and what God is doing in us. So I want you to think for a moment, you know, without it being too spiritual, without it being too carried away into, you know, things of the spirit, but I want you to begin to step out of the physical realm and head towards that area of lack of understanding that we call the spiritual realm, or the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. For without it being the Spirit of God, breathing life, as we said, or quickening, as it says in the King James, or making fit that which does not fit into your life of that with which you read about your life, when you find it in the Bible, the book of books, then only God, as being God, could make that fit, that which does not fit, but does fit as you see how it fits into your life. Does that make sense to you? I didn't think so. So that's why we have to go spiritual. Because trying to put it into practical terms, ain't going to work too well. So, in school of the Bible, let's listen for a minute. And this is a lesson in learning now. You listen more than you talk. You pause at times to get perspective if God is speaking. Because if he's speaking, he's not going to interrupt you. He's going to shut up, or he's going to keep talking, and you won't hear what he has to say, because it's the Spirit of God that gives ears to hear what the Spirit of God is saying. And also, to put it bluntly, he is the one who causes you to remember what God has said, or what Jesus has said too. He's also the one that gives you the ability to understand what Jesus said, God said, and what the Spirit of God is saying. So we'll pray for a minute and ask the Spirit of God to come and take over. So, Father, I pray and I thank you that you are the Spirit of God. I thank you that not only are you the Spirit of God, but you are the Son of God. So, Jesus, I thank you for who you are. And, Father, I thank you that you are the Father of Jesus and the one who sent us the Spirit of God, that he should lead us into all truth. God, I thank you that you are God. What that means, I don't know, God, but I do know that you are Father. And I know when I talk to you how different that is than when I talk to you, Jesus, as being the Son of God, and when I talk to you as being the Son of Man. When you're the Son of God, I'm a little nervous. When you're the Son of Man, I'm a little comforted. But thank you, Jesus, for praying to the Father and asking him, while seated there, that you would send the Comforter to us, that he is giving us conviction, but also comfort. He's giving us conformability to your will, but also conflicting us in ways that we have to do something about ourselves so that we would ask him to lead us in ways we don't understand. So God, right now, everyone that's watching, everyone that's listening, everyone that's hearing, and everyone that's seeing, by the Spirit of God, by whom you have sent, lead them. Amen. So now, let's trust in the Lord with all our heart. Let's lean not on our own understanding, but let's in our way now acknowledge he's teaching us as we listen to Jesus speak. Bible taught or spiritual taught or spirit taught, it may shock some readers to suggest that there is a difference between being one, Bible taught, or being two, spirit taught. Nevertheless, it is so. Aren't they the same, one and of the other? No, and may it never be. It is altogether possible to be instructed in the rudiments of the faith and still have no real understanding of the entire matter. As a matter of fact, you could begin in the beginning and read to the end and not understand the fullness of what is in between. And it is possible to go on to become an expert in Bible doctrine and not have any spiritual illumination, with the results that a veil remains over the mind and preventing it from apprehending the truth in its spiritual essence. As a matter of fact, in our modern day, one of the greatest examples of having a veil placed over a spiritual understanding of something that's happening in a practical biblical doctrine is the sadness of what John MacArthur has done in his latter days. Being that he is a phenomenal Bible scholar of much doctrine and much teaching and preaching and studying of only the Bible, he hasn't approached the things of the Spirit by allowing for the Spirit of God to teach him. So he denies that availability and tells people that are led by the Spirit of God are false, even to the point of condemning Calvary Chapels and Billy Graham's and other people that talk about the Holy Spirit and the Spirit of God. And that's a modern example of what Tozer is talking about. You can know all Bible doctrine and you could be a dynamic man of God and not get to the place of knowing the Spirit. There was another great man of God that wrote a book called Near the Flame. I think it was Charles, I wish I could remember the name of the man. He was a great Bible teacher, Christianity, Christians loved him, born again Christians were reading his books, and he read them, you'd read them and read them and read them, and he never condemned anyone, but he was always wonderful in his Bible teaching. You know, you learn from him. I mean, it was just unbelievable. And then after, I guess, maybe 20 or 30 years of ministry, suddenly he wrote a book that talked about the Holy Spirit. He said he didn't believe in him. He didn't believe that you could be baptized in the Holy Spirit. He didn't believe the gifts of the Spirit. He didn't believe in all these things. But then, in the middle of the book, he's telling you that he had an encounter with the Holy Spirit, and suddenly he's had to change his way of thinking. 30 years. Top of his game. Head of the, you know, hierarchy. He was like a man of God, you know, esteemed by his elders and his people and Christendom as being this great Bible teacher and this great author. And he didn't have the Holy Spirit until he wrote that Near the Flame. You can look it up in some place in your Google or someplace, you know, if you've got a Google, go search Near the Flame. Really fascinating story about the man. And now he's, you know, wrote a lot of books since then that are like, wow, you know, over the top. But that's probably what John MacArthur needs, so you could pray for him. Most of us are acquainted with churches that teach the Bible to their children from their tenderest years and teach them long instructions in the catechism or the training, the catechism, and drill them further in pastor's classes, and still never producing them a living Christianity nor a viral godliness. In other words, they have the ability to do what they're told to do.
They know what is right to do. They look godly, but they have no power therein. And Jesus talked about that. He talked about his day having scribes and Pharisees that said one thing and did another, and some of them were hypocrites. He had, as it were, the ability to feed 5,000, to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to do all kinds of miracles, because he had the power of God with him. But those that were the leaders of the religious system in his day, they didn't, did they? They hadn't heard from God, according to what some of the scholars say, and it's not true, but according to some of the scholars say, over 400 years. It's exaggeration, but it's, you know, an understanding of what's going on at those times. So they were knowledgeable of the Word of God. They knew the Torah. They knew everything of prophecy, and yet they didn't do miracles. God wasn't with them. God wasn't in them. God wasn't leading them. Interesting. We find today that we have lots of people that can do the same thing. They have the knowledge thereof, but not the power. To get power, you have to have a source. And the source has to come from God and return back to God, or else it's not an accurate portrayal of who God is, what God is, and the nature of the Spirit of God. They don't not only have not godliness or a viral godliness, their members show no evidence of having passed from death into life. They have a dry, drab, and wearying working out of that with which they feel they have to work in. They work from the outside to make their godliness a form of religious observance to work inside that which they think is going to bring out that nature of the quality of can only be placed within a person by the fruit of the Spirit of the peace, love, and joy, but they think they will attain to it by doing of works of righteousness from the outside to shove it on the inside, so to speak. Or in some way, the structure will produce the result. Once you build it, it will be filled. Or once it's there, they will come. Kind of like Field of Dreams in a way. Once you build it, they'll show up. Well, it doesn't work with God. You can build something, but if God doesn't build the house, the labors in vain. Their members show no evidence of having passed from death into life, and they live as though they are death walking. None of the earmarks of salvation so plainly indicated in the scriptures are found among them. They don't have a joy. They don't observably demonstrate peace. They have little love. Their religious lives are correct and reasonably moral, but wholly mechanical and altogether lacking in radiance. Boy, don't I know that word. They wear their faith as persons in mourning. Once wore black armbands to show their love and respect for the departed. Such persons cannot be dismissed as hypocrites. Many of them are pathetically serious about it all. They mean it, and they live it, and they do it. And they're serious, and they're sincere. They are simply blind. They are deaf. They have not the Spirit of God. From lack of the vital Spirit, they are forced to get along with the outward shell of faith, while all the time their deep hearts are starving for a spiritual reality that they don't comprehend, and they don't know what is wrong with them. They're doing the right thing. They have been right in their actions and right in their attitudes, but something's lacking on the inside because they're only observing things on the outside. This difference between the religion of creed and the religion of the Spirit is well set forth by the saintly Thomas in a tender little prayer to his Lord. The children of Israel in times past said unto Moses, "Speak thou with us, and we will hear. But let not God speak with us, lest we die." Interesting. Think about that for a minute. The children of Israel spoke to Moses and said, "Look, you go talk to God, and we'll listen to what God tells you. But don't have God speak to us, because it scares the willies out of us, and we'll die for fright." That's kind of what I said in the beginning about if you want to find God, you have to want God. But if you don't want God for some reason, you won't find God. God will not reveal himself to someone unless that person wants to find God.
Not so, Lord, not so, I beseech you, but rather with the prophet Samuel, I humbly and earnestly pray, O God, speak, for your servant listens.
And that's really kind of what we hear in School of the Bible and VidDevo Church in relating information and talking in VidDevo Bible about a lot of things that we do. We stop. We pause. We wait. We've even done some times where we just went still and let God do what He will do. We choose to abide by the promptings at times to say nothing. Or we choose not to speak unless God has something to say. For if it was not God speaking, you would not see this video. It would be erased, put away, destroyed, or in some way never presented as though God were speaking through me, much less through whoever we put in front of VidDevo, because there may be times other people. But the expectation, the confident realization, the knowledge that God in me is God through me and God speaking is what God is doing to me as I listen to what He has to say, as the Spirit is the one that teaches us. For it is not I that live, but Christ liveth in me. And so I choose not to speak of what I want to do, but I keep buffeting myself inside to only use that with which God chooses to use to speak through these lips that are but His, to be demonstrating that with which a spiritual person can do when they yield themselves to the Holy Spirit to speak as He chooses. O Lord God, you speak, the inspirer and the enlightener of all the prophets, for you alone, without them, canst perfectly instruct me. But they without you can profit nothing. They indeed may utter words, but they cannot give the Spirit. Only you are the one who gives the Spirit, and without measure you are able to do so. Most beautiful do they speak, but if thou be silent, they inflame not the heart. They teach the letter, but thou openest the senses. They bring forth mysteries, but thou unlockest the meaning of sealed things. They work only outwardly, but you instruct and enlighten the heart. You are on the inside, while they are working on the outside. They cry aloud with words, but you impart understanding to the hearing. You know, it'd be hard to wrap it up better than that. The same thing has been said vicariously or variously by others. However, the most familiar saying probably is this. The scriptures to be understood must be read with the same spirit that they originally inspired them. I'm like, well, okay. In other words, if you don't have that spirit, the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost, the Spirit that was there when He spoke through men that wrote down and recorded for us the book, then you don't have the same meaning or understanding unless that Spirit that gave them and saw what they wrote and helped them to write it gives you the ability to read it in the same light of what He spoke to them in the first place or caused them to see and to write and to bring to us today in reading the Scripture. So when we read it without that same Spirit, dare I say, you haven't a clue of what God wants to do. No one denies this, but even such a statement will go over the heads of those who hear it unless the Holy Spirit causes them to hear it with ears to hear and a heart to receive it. The scriptures to be understood must be read with the same spirit that originally inspired them. We choose to say it this way at VidDevo Church, at VidDevo Ministries, at School of the Bible, at our education department, and everywhere we go, really. The Word of God, which usually is considered the Bible, but God can speak in other ways. That's why we say the Word of God. The Word of God by the Spirit of God to the people of God of the Son of God, Jesus. Doesn't get any simpler for us than that. It is all God, and it's all by the Spirit of God. Otherwise, we're not doing it, and we won't choose to use it or be a part of it. The charge often made against us
and those that are led by the Spirit, is that we are bibliolaters. Is probably not true in the same sense as meant by our detractors, but candor self-analysis will force us to admit that there is often too much truth in that charge. We worship the Bible by saying, the Bible says, as opposed to God says. I often say in my own teaching to anyone that will listen, what did Jesus tell you to do? What did Jesus say? What, in some way, did you understand him to mean when he told you that? Or how are you today hearing his voice? One of the things I've done, I've heard God speak audibly to me. I've told people this thousands of times, over and over and over and over and over again, until it's kind of like old hat for me, old routines. But the fact of the matter is, God spoke direct. Now, I'd already been studying scriptures for a long time. I had some issues in my personal life that were like overwhelming me. I was desperate for God, and believe me, when I'm desperate, I'm desperate. Oh boy, I could tell you some stories. Desperate, hey. You know, my wife will tell you, you know, if I think something's like not good for me, dumpster it. That wasn't the word I was going to come up with from the Marine Corps days, but anyways, hey, I get rid of it. It's no hesitation. Boom, gone, you know. Cut it out. Cut it off, cut it out, and get rid of it. I wish I could be confident enough to cut off some of my members. I'd probably do that. Of course, my imagination, I can't cut that out, so I have to program it. But you get the point, is that God speaks as he chooses to. God directs as he chooses to. God will reveal himself to you as he chooses to. You ought to consider whether or not you want him to. Being that many people in our modern day will tell you, the Bible says, I will answer you this, in and of that we're talking about the school of the Bible. I wasted a lot of time. It's not a waste, but I like to say it was a waste of time. Only because it makes people that go to theology school or Bible school feel better. But I wasted a lot of time studying in depth church history, theology, all the different, you know, major schools that are out there and all the different papers that they post and the thesis that they have. Studied from overseas when I was in Jerusalem and overseas in Hebrew University. Other things from different perspectives that are translated into English that I could understand that come from a whole different way of viewing everything, you know, including scripture, life, general, and philosophy, and everything. I mean, there's just a wealth of material out there that comes from a wide variety of knowledge. And I can tell you this, that, yeah, I could sit down and you can come to an intellectual, like C.S. Lewis did in some way, an intellectual apprehension of the nature of God, the will of God, what God is, how God does, how God exists, and all that kind of stuff by having a high IQ, which I, you know, fairly do, you know, somewhat. And you'll come to some conclusions that are accurate. I mean, geniuses discover there is a God. When a genius tells me there is no God, I know what he's doing. He's lying to, you know, you, not to me, because I know he knows that there is a God. He's just dealing with something else because he doesn't want to deal with God direct. The point being is this. You can't come to it in the Word of God without the Spirit of God, but you will not have a relationship and you will not get any closer than that. You will not bridge the gap between the knowledge of God without knowing God, and the only way to know God is God must bridge that gap. We call it salvation, but that's not what I'm talking about. It must be that which is of the Spirit of God, because as we said, these that are saying the Bible says often are saved, but have no power thereof to do anything about being saved. They just exist with the faith that God will save them, and on that day of salvation he shall. But they are still babes, as though they were waddling and swaddling clothes and lying in a manger and never once grown up to become the full stature of what the measure of faith God requires of us to become sons and daughters of God, as we are led by the Spirit of God. That truth is in its essence a spiritual must constantly be before our minds if we would know the truth indeed. Jesus Christ himself is the truth, and he cannot be confined to mere words, even though, as we ardently believe, he has himself inspired the words. It's not just the word itself being made flesh, but it is Jesus in the flesh, Jesus in the Word, Jesus as the living Word, Jesus being God, Jesus being Son of God, Jesus speaking, talking, walking, and having relationship with you. He has himself inspired the words that which is spiritual cannot be shut in by ink or fenced in by type and paper. The best a book can do is to give us the letter of truth, and if we receive more than this, it must be by the Holy Spirit who gives it. It is not the letter of the law, for even Jesus said, "You search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, but they are which speak of me. Lo, from volume to volume, it is me in the midst thereof." The great need of the hour among persons spiritually hungry is twofold. First is that the spiritual person who wants to know the Spirit of God, that wants to grow in the Spirit of God, know the scriptures, apart from which there can be no saving truth. And we will vouchsafe that with our Lord. But the second is to be enlightened by the Spirit, apart from which the scriptures cannot be understood, for without them going hand in hand, the Bible on one hand, the Spirit on the other, you do not have the Word of God. You have the Word of a man's understanding and an interpretation thereof. So by the Spirit of God, as we study through the school of the Bible, we're always going to come back to that realization that it's got to be by the Spirit, in the Spirit, of the Spirit, and the Spirit of God teaching us, and not that of man. For surely it is of Jesus that we talk, Jesus that we move, and in Jesus we live and have our being. For if God is not alive and God is not real, then you're missing out on what God intended, and you only have a portion of what God wants to fulfill in reality of every day of your life. For the abundant life is this, that they should know Jesus and know him who sent him. Your abundancy does not come in prosperity, for God will prosper even the ungodly as well as the godly, but rather your abundant life comes in the knowledge of Jesus, in the growing in a relationship of him, so that he would make you one with his Father. And the only way that you can come to that appreciation of that is by asking God and wanting him really more than what you think you do, more than what you want to do, more than life itself, until you cry out, you really won't be saved. Until you hear from God himself, you really haven't all that God intended for you. As we study in the school of the Bible, we want to bring you to that knowledge of going the extra mile, of having to do things that may not make you smile and feel, oh, I'm a happy camper now, but rather you come into contact with the living God. And as we started in the beginning, I am that I am, I will be what I will be. God is righteous and holy and true, and he's not beyond sending anyone to hell. And I don't care who thinks they know, or what they know, or how they know. The fact of the matter is, eternity is on the doorstep of our, on the cusp of our reality, in the forefront of our mind as we will approach death and one day have to cross over into eternity, knowing that we're either in heaven or we are eternally damned in hell. And that lake of fire is waiting to absorb all that with which those that have not made that realization come true in their life of knowing God. It will be a reality check for them to know God in a way they never intended and God never wanted for them to be. And that is in a place of damnation for eternity. So let's come to a conclusion here in School of the Bible. Let's move forward knowing this. We want to know Jesus and we want to know his Father. We want to absorb everything the Spirit of God before he is pulled from the earth and as he wanes in his holding back that which is evil on the world as he's doing so now. But as he begins to recede as the tide goes in and out, but as he's pulling back, getting ready to take back into heaven those with which God has called, let us all choose to follow not after the things of the world. Let us choose to deny ourselves the things of the flesh. But rather let us, each and every one of us, determine for ourselves that we will now begin to walk forward and move forward, especially in school of the Bible, to learn the things of the Spirit by the Spirit of God and to be led as God chooses to lead us so that we would be called no longer Christian, but sons and daughters of God. Thank you.